So today we're going to continue, and I'm about to switch mics, but we're going to continue with testing. We're going to continue with the teaching that we have been doing on Healing the Hurts, Church Hurts. There's a microphone that will circulate out there amongst the congregation because I want this, again, to be an interactive teaching. Amen. And so we started last week, but we're going to pick up with part two today. So stand to your feet real quick. Get your Bible in your hand as we go forward with our Bible declaration on this morning. Amen. As I take the opportunity as you go forward to, deal with my personal summer right now. Amen. So, hallelujah. The Lord is good. Glory to God. And so, I think my husband wants to, you want me to switch? I'm going to switch back. All right, I'll switch back and stay with this one. All right, so get your Bible in your air. Get your Bible in your hand and lift it up in the air. Amen. And let us go forward this morning with our Bible declaration. Sorry to those that are tuning in. Amen. Did you reset Periscope? I'm not sure, but reset Periscope. Amen. Periscope is that one over there. Amen. It's just cool, and so we want to actually go out and then click it for everyone to actually join in instead of making it private. Amen. And so you all have your Bibles in your hand. Go ahead and lift them up in the air as we go forward with our Bible declaration on this morning. Amen. Come on.
This is my Bible. This is my sword. My instructions for life in Jesus Christ our Lord. I shall hear it, receive it, apply it, and obey. Share with others who don't know the way.
My heart is open, so have your way. Speak to me, Lord. Speak today. In Jesus' name, I'll never be the same. Speak to me, Lord. Speak today. Dear Father, we just ask that you continue to be with us as we get into the Word of God on today. Father God, use me as your servant just to be able to minister the Word of God so that people can have understanding and so that people can get healed from the many different things that they have experienced. Father, we thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You all may be seated. Amen. As I say, this is part two of the teaching on healing the hurt, dealing with church hurt. I'm not going to do a review at all. So if you want to get part one, go to my YouTube page, Apostle Tanya Mitchell, and you will find it there or on my Facebook page. And so I want to just start out with a church quote, a quote about church hurt. You all know I like quotes, amen? And so there's a quote that says, sometimes we get hurt by specific people in the church. But if we allow those people to make us bitter towards the body, Satan claims the victory. And the enemy has claimed the victory way too long because there's been too many people in the body of Christ for too long bitter with other people, amen? I also thought about the fact that Jesus, he said that he didn't come for those that was well. Amen. He came for those that were sick. And so we're in the body of Christ. We are working on ourselves. We have issues. And so I thought about this particular quote that said, ministry is messy because sin is messy. Get over it. Get a mop and start helping people clean up. That's what we're here for. They come into the house of God sick with all their different issues. And sometimes when you are sick, you infect other people. You can affect other people. But you should not let that stop you from trying to help them to get better when you understand the church is a hospital. So we're going to look at our foundational text, amen, Psalm chapter 55. And we're going to start at verse 1. This is the foundational text that I've been using for this particular teaching on church hurt. Amen. And so Psalm chapter 55, and we're going to start at verse 1. I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. Amen. Bless the Lord, Marie, that is tuned in. Amen. Sister Cash, I see you on. Hello, Tanya Hardy. Bless you. And so Psalm 55, starting at verse 1, it says, give ear to my prayer, O God, and do not hide yourself from my supplication. Attend to me and hear me. I am restless in my complaint and moan noisily. Because oftentimes when we are hurt and when we're going through different things, we make it known to the Lord. Amen. We got a lot of conversations that's going on in our head and in our minds. Amen. And so he said, because of the voice. because of the oppression of the wicked. For they bring down trouble upon me, and in wrath they hate me. My heart is severely pained within me, and the terrors of death have fallen upon me. Fearlessness and trembling have come upon me, and horror has overwhelmed me. So I say, because sometimes when you've been hurt, you feel like this right here. He says, so I said, oh, that I had wings like a dove. I would fly away and be at rest. Indeed, I will wander far off and remain in the wilderness. Go down to verse 12. And it says, for it is not an enemy who reproaches me. As I said, David is going through some things in this particular passage of scripture, and he's letting it be known that it's not an enemy that I have a problem with. Amen. He said, it's not an enemy who reproaches me. Then I could bear that. I can handle somebody that's hating on me, that's an enemy towards me, because guess what? We don't have no real relationship for real. And so he says, nor is it one who hates me who has exalted himself against me. Then I can hide from him. But it was you, a man, my equal, my companion, and my acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked to the house of God in the throne. Somebody that I fellowship with, another believer. He's expressing, you was my friend. You was my acquaintance. We worshiped together. We went to the house of the Lord together. So it is a church folk that has hurt him and got him in this particular place. Look at verse 15. And it says, let death seize them. Let them go down alive into hell. For the wickedness is in their dwellings and among them. Last week when I read this particular passage of scripture, I did not read verse 15. But I was led to read verse 15 on today, because I want you to see how it expresses the real state of mind of an individual that has been hurt. The real emotions that they actually go through. I like the Message translation. And the Message translation of verse 15, it said, haul my betrayers off alive to hell. Let them experience the horror. Let them feel every desolate detail of a damned life. Let me give you the definition of a damned life so you don't think I'm cussing, amen? Because I'm using it in the right context, the way it was written in the Message translation. Because y'all know me, I got a problem with all these cussing preachers, amen? I'm just keeping it real. And so the word damned, as defined in Christian belief, means condemned by God to suffer eternal punishment in hell. He was upset. And he wanted the individuals to feel some pain. Oftentimes, people who have been hurt often want the individuals that hurt them to hurt because of the anger and the rage that they are feeling because of what they have experienced. Amen. Amen. Lipstick. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All right. All right. Bless the Lord. Okay. Are we good? Thank you, Jesus. Anything can happen when you're going live. Amen. Is that better? Oh. Okay. I'm trying to get it. All right. I got it. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. I so appreciate that. Can I just say that? You know, I'm pausing. We live. And I appreciate that. Because, you know, a lot of times.
I've been trying to get
your attention. But y'all know, for real, we would talk with people. Right. They would have little Martians hanging out and things of that nature. And we don't say nothing. But yet we looking at it like, oh, my God. But we don't say nothing. And then once you leave their presence and you look in the mirror, you're like, oh, my God. They let me sit there in front of them like that. That wasn't a Martian, y'all, okay? But thank y'all for pointing out to me that I had something going on. Amen. Thank you, Kim Cash. She said, I look good. Hey, I'm trying. Anyway, let's get back to the word. And so, when it comes down to it, hurt people often hurt people because they have not been healed. Because they have not been healed. And what we have to understand is that oftentimes when we get saved and we come to the Lord, we have experienced so much stuff in the world prior to salvation that has hurt us that we come into the kingdom of God damaged goods. And so hurt people often hurt people because they have not been healed. They hurt people who have done absolutely nothing to them. But they are often unaware that they are hurting other people. Again, they're hurt. They come in contact with people. And they hurt the people that they come in contact with. But they don't even realize that they have hurt the people that they have come in contact with. And so I want to share with you some common traits hurt people display in their interactions. Amen. With other people. Some common traits and... This is something that I actually shared at the Shepherd Connection, the fellowship that I have for ministry leaders, amen? And I shared this with the Shepherd Connection because when you are individuals that deal with people on a consistent basis, when we stand in this position to shepherd people and lead people and things of that nature, we have to make sure that we keep ourselves in the right perspective as we're dealing with them before we end up getting caught up, hurt, and bitter, amen? And so when dealing with people, you must understand them. You must understand them and what they're going through in order to guard your heart properly without taking things personally. And so this is an article from a young man named Joseph Matera, and I just want to share with you some highlighted points about traits, amen, that individuals that are hurt display. And so hurt people often transfer their inner anger onto their family and close friends. They take it out on other people. People that's closest to them. Again, as I said, people that did absolutely nothing to them. Another one of the common traits is that hurt people interpret every word spoken to them through the prism of their pain. Mm-hmm. See, they hear everything that a person says from their place of pain. And so because of their pain, ordinary words are often misinterpreted to mean something negative towards them. Therefore, they are extremely sensitive and act out of pain instead of reality. So you got to understand what they're going through. Amen. And so you can have a simple conversation with them, be expressing your heart or just a general conversation, and it will get twisted because they hurt. It will sound like something somebody else said that hurt them. And so they will analyze it from their place of hurt. Not only do they interpret every word spoken through the prism of their pain, they also have a tendency to interpret every action through the prism of their pain. Everything that you do, they are sizing it up, trying to figure out what your motive is and some. Amen. Their emotional pain causes them to suspect wrong motives or evil intent behind other people's actions towards them. And so your motives can be pure, but trust and believe, because they are damaged goods, they don't receive it as pure. There's something wrong with what you're doing because of what they have experienced in their life and where they are. They haven't been healed. Hurt people often portray themselves as victims, and they carry a victim spirit. Woe is me. Always going through with a victim spirit. Hurt people have a hard time entering into trusting relationships. They can't form good relationships because they're always hurting. They're always suspicious. They've been through so much that even when you are pure and genuine, they can't see you the way they need to see you because they are blinded by their hurt. And again, some come into the church with mountains of hurt, things that they've dealt with years from multiple people, some true and some not true. And so when they're in that particular state, it's hard for them to have good relationships with people. Every time you turn around, something goes on. And so hurt people often carry around a suspicious spirit because they're thinking that, when you gonna do it? It's just a matter of time before you hurt me, because everybody that I deal with hurts me. So you bought me this, or you did this for me. What is this really about? What's your motive? Because for real, oftentimes they have a hard time accepting that people can really love them for them. They have a hard time accepting that people can genuinely like them and want to deal with them. So they're constantly suspicious because of their hurts. Hurt people often alienate others, and then they have the nerve to wonder why no one is there for them. Can I tell y'all, I didn't write this. I love when I read stuff like this, because I ain't write it. Because you know, for real, sometimes when I read something like this, a person's mind will tell them that I'm saying this about them. Can I just be for real? Next thing you know, they didn't even know about the church hurt. I ain't write this, y'all. Blame it on Joseph. Amen. He's the author. Amen. But it is so true. Hurt people have a tendency to alienate themselves from other people. And then they want to know, why ain't nobody ever there for me? Why nobody don't ever support me? Why can't I be? Why ain't nobody there when I need them? I'm there for everybody else. This is what they think. So, but they don't realize, boo, you done cut yourself off from everybody. I'll never forget, I talked to somebody not long ago. Hadn't talked to them about a year. Did I reach out to this individual? Yes. But guess what? This individual called me and said, hey, how you doing? I said, fine. They talking about, where you been? I've been where I've always been. Where you been is the question. Because I haven't been missing in action. You have.
Right.
And so a lot of times when individuals are going through different things, guess what? They have a tendency to alienate themselves. And so while they are in the midst of their messed up state, alienated, they're looking at others and trying to figure out what's wrong with the other people and wondering why people aren't there for them. When it comes down to it, hurt people are often frustrated and depressed because past pain continually spills over into their present consciousness. That was a major thing that I dealt with in the revival this weekend. There was a lot of individuals that were dealing with a lot of hurt and a lot of pain and a lot of anger. And so the bottom line is, it will cause you to be frustrated. It will cause you to be depressed because you're holding on to it instead of releasing it. You're holding on to it instead of getting healed from it. Hurt people often erupt with inappropriate emotion because particular words, actions, or circumstances touch and trigger past woundedness. He said, I've been in situations with people in which there was a gross overreaction to a word I spoke or an action that was taken. Although I was shocked and thought this reaction came out of left field, it was really the person responded to an accumulation of years of hurt and pain that could not help but spill over in various situations. That right there I can relate to personally because of some things that have recently transpired. And we began to talk last weekend. My sister, she got up here and she said some things about how she was, you know, just really upset with me. And I knew it, amen. And I thank God for this particular teaching, amen, because it's a teaching to actually heal. But sometimes an individual, because I know when she was talking, she said, I'll talk to you about my part, but we didn't get to that part. But one of the things that happens is sometimes because of what we're going through, we can overreact. And we can overreact, and for real, it's bigger than what it is that you're actually dealing with on the table. And so it can go back to something deeper, and it's because of the emotions that are still there from past hurts. So all of a sudden you find yourself overreacting to something, because guess what? A word may have triggered something. When it come down to it, an action may have triggered something. And so we have to be mindful of that. But oftentimes that will happen. Hurt people often erupt with inappropriate emotion because of particular words, actions, or circumstances that touch and trigger past woundedness. Sometimes you have to get to a point where you can see this that manifested wasn't a result of this. What you see is one thing, but you got to be able to realize it's because of something else. And so hurt people often occupy themselves with busyness, work, performance, and or accomplishments as ways of compensating for low self-esteem, trying to keep themselves busy to make themselves feel good about who they are. Hurt people often attempt to medicate themselves with excessive entertainment, drugs, alcohol, pornography, sexual relationships, or hobbies as a way to forget their pain and run from reality. Just in a natural sense, those of us who have been in relationships and have gotten hurt in a relationship, before we can heal, we done jumped into another one. Rebound relationships is what I call them. But you haven't healed, but you're hurt, and you think that getting into another one is going to help you to overcome and get your mind over the hurt that you are dealing with, and that doesn't work. You can get high, you can get drunk, you can do all of those type of things, but guess what? You still won't remember the hurt. Sometimes it may temporarily block your mind off for a minute, and sometimes you can get drunk and tore up, and it makes you think about it even more. Now you're just having a depressed party all by yourself, intoxicated. And so you try to get away from it. You try to medicate it instead of deal with it. Hurt people are often self-absorbed with their own pain and are unaware that they are hurting other people. Because all they can see is me, 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 me. What's going on with me? What people did with me? How I feel? Never taking into consideration how others may be feeling that you have hurt. Not taking into consideration how you alienating yourself is affecting others. Not take, because all you can see is, I'm doing this because of this, and on and on and on. And so, hurt people are often self-absorbed with their own pain, are unaware that they are hurting other people. They are often insensitive to other people because their emotional pain limits their capacity for empathy and their capacity for self-awareness. I like when Mary got up here last week. She said one thing about it. When you're dealing with hurt, that's all you see. You don't see nothing else. Your thinking is off. Your logic is off. Your reason is off, because that's all you see. And everything you do comes from what you see and where you are. Hurt people are susceptible to demonic deception. He said, I am convinced that most of the divisions in the church are caused by saints who lack emotional health and project their pain onto others. If the church would deal more with the emotional health of individuals, there would be less of a foothold of demonic infiltration. Also, there would be stronger relationships, stronger marriages, healthier children, and a more balanced approach to ministry with less of a chance of pastoral and congregational burnout. And then, God often purposely surfaces pain so that hurt people can face reality. So that you can face reality. God will allow stuff to hurt you to help you to deal with what's already in you. He got to bring it to the surface. Because sometimes when you've been hurt so long, you have mastered going through life suppressing it and not dealing with it. But just because you suppressed it, just because you have cut yourself off from some people, just because you left that church when you got hurt at, that doesn't mean that you've been healed. And so whether it is because of a marriage problem or continual personal conflicts on the job, God often allows conflict and spillover because he wants the infection to stop spreading and for the person to be healed. Often Christians are fighting the devil and blaming him for conflict when in essence, God often allows conflict so that people would be motivated to dig deeper into their lives to deal with the root cause of destructive thoughts and habit patterns. Habits that you actually have, amen? And so the bottom line is, he wants you to deal with that stuff. And if you don't get to the root cause of a thing, how many of y'all know it's going to come up again? See, you can cut yourself off, isolate yourself off, do all different type of things, get high, whatever the case may be, have 1,000 relationships. But guess what? You can cut it off at the surface, but that root is still there and it's coming up again. The only way that you can stop it from coming up again is that you uproot it. Amen? And so that's something that we don't necessarily do. And so last week when we came together, I began to share with you some of the comments that individuals shared on Facebook, and I was really blessed by that, amen? I had did a survey on Facebook asking people, will his church hurt? And I was asking them to give examples. One of the things that I love is God knows what he's doing. Because I told you all, people were so honest on that feed until it was unreal. That's a public site. And people could see it. But it was pulling up some stuff in people. And people was expressing what they were really feeling. So I went through on Friday. And I said, I'm not dealing with technology. Because y'all know last week the iPad was moving a little slow and stuff. So I said, I'm going to type out everything. I'm going to write down everything. Because this is something, who knows, I could use again in the future. So I took the opportunity to type out every single comment that was placed on that Facebook page. I got to one of the comments on the Facebook page, which was a little deep. It was real deep, even to the point that they actually named the person, and I won't name the person. But I responded back to that individual, letting them know I'm so sorry about what they've actually experienced and let them know that I will be praying for them. Well, I looked at my notifications and I saw that I had a response back from this person. But when I went back to the response, it was gone. And the thing is, this individual responded underneath the comment of another person. And there was a lot of comments under that person. But that comment was too close to what they knew about. And that individual who originally started the comment deleted it, which meant it deleted every comment afterwards. But how many of y'all know I still got it? I still got it, amen? They always say, sometimes you can put stuff out there in cyberspace. You may think it's gone because you hit the delete button, but that don't mean it's gone. And so, we're going to talk about some of these things, amen? I pray that even as I respond back to some of the comments of individuals that wrote these comments are tuning in, I pray that they don't get offended by how I address the comments. Because again, when you deal with hurt, when people are hurt, they see things from their perspective. Sometimes they can be young in life when something happens and really don't understand stuff, but yet they carry that stuff for years, amen? But I do want to talk about the real hurts, amen? And so we started, and one individual said that being sat down for something I didn't do, something that they didn't do, losing all my roles in the church, now I'm a heathen or backslider full time. The bottom line is, there's an issue when you get sat down for something that you didn't do. But how many of y'all know people get upset when they get sat down for something that they did do? You won't get sat down if you didn't do anything. But yet, if a pastor stands in a position where they have to put things in place to have order in the church, that individual who no longer gets to serve in their assignments, they sometimes get hurt. What happens oftentimes in ministry or in the lives of people when they are hurt, they rarely take the opportunity to look at what they did. All they're looking at is what happened, but they're not looking at how we got to this particular point. And so I can understand being hurt for something that you didn't do, losing all the roles in the church. Another individual said, any act perceived or actual by a member of the church, particularly a leader, that disappoints, betrays, or fails to meet the expectation of another. Example, I'm there every time the doors open. I give as much as I can. But when my so-and-so died, no one came to visit me. Not one of them came to visit me. I know a young woman that actually joined this church because she was at a church for a while. Active in the church, served in the church, faithful in the church. And she went through some things. I think it was a physical challenge that she went through. She got sick. And one of the things that she said is that nobody ever reached out to her. Nobody ever, you know, reached out to her to see how she was doing or anything of that nature. Then when she finally went back to the church, then all of a sudden everybody like, hey, how you doing? I've been thinking about you. And it's like, no, if you really thought about you, me, you would have called me. You would have reached out to me. But now that I'm back here, you acting like it's all good again. But for real, you ain't pick up the phone to check on me at all. That stuff really hurts people. One thing about it, I know that you can only do but so much, but that's why I tell the people in the church, guess what? We are family. So if you notice somebody is missing, don't come to me. Reach out to them yourself. Let them know that you care too. Because it's one thing if I hear from a pastor, but I got 30 other people and ain't not one of them reached out to me. Sometimes that does hurt a person. Now, you can reach out to a person. They're not always responsive sometimes and because of where they may be. But one thing I can say for me personally is that people can never say that they were missing in action, didn't show up, and I didn't reach out to them. After a while, you leave them alone. But periodically, I may go back and reach out. But people get hurt when they don't see that you genuinely care. What is it going to kill you to pick up a phone and call a person? And like I said, this individual's like, I gave my money. I am there all the times when the door opened and so-and-so passed away and not one of them reached out. That does hurt. Now let me explain this. There's different levels of hurt. There are some things that I consider to be petty in the church. Some things that people call hurt. Some things, I'm not going to say petty. Small, and you have some deeper issues. They mean different levels. And so, let me give you another one. Line leadership. I can understand that because you expect your leaders to be in a position of leading by example. You don't want no line leadership. That does hurt you when you have trusted this man or woman that's supposed to lead you and you find out that they can't tell the truth about nothing. Somebody else said, my sister's pastor tried to sleep with her. It messed her up. I can't tell you how many people that I know that have been messed up from sleeping with their pastor. Let me tell y'all something. Oh, it happens a lot in the church. And that's a deep hurt. But can I tell you this? That's a deep hurt. Come here, Deanna. I don't want you, but come here. Come on up here. Now, the bottom line is, we got to look at this thing because we got to take responsibility. Deanna is my member, one of the members that I pastor in this church. Deacon James is my husband. Now, if I'm operating in my flesh and I propose to you to have a night of passion with me, at that moment, you have an option. I can try and be all on you. What you gonna do? You gonna stand there like that? The reality is, he got an option. And people fail to realize, okay, so guess what? I propose, he know I'm married, he gives into it. We do it. And the bottom line is, now he all caught up, nose open, wanna be in a relationship. You was just a rendezvous. You was a side piece. I hit you up when I'm in need. But we ain't in no relationship. Now, because you can't have me as your woman, because I got a husband, and our stuff is on the down low because you my secret lover, now he get an attitude. Go sit down. He now got an attitude. Because he has slept with the pastor. By choice. I ain't rape him. He was willing. And I'ma tell you. Yeah, you got some strong manipulating demons in pulpits. And they prey on weak people. But at the end of the day, you've made a conscious decision. Because you knew it before you did it. That it wasn't right. Should you be hurt if your pastor come on to you? Yes. It's out of order. But it shouldn't devastate you to the point where you don't want to have anything else to do with God, because all pastors are not like that. But if you have engaged in it willingly, got caught up in it for years willingly, and they already let you know they ain't leaving their wife for you, now you're mad, you're angry, and you're bitter, but you are overlooking the role you played by saying yes. And I'm going to tell you, you got some leaders that will throw things out in the atmosphere at you to see if you're going to bite. See, because you could have a straight face and be like, sister ain't playing, or you can have a little different kind of response to something that they say that ain't right. We'll let them know it's a matter of time before I get hurt. It's a matter of time. Oh, I know this stuff personally. And so the bottom line is, I can understand that individual. And it said it messed her up, because it will mess you up if your spiritual leader wants to sleep with you. As I said, we have all these sons and daughters, but there's a whole bunch of spiritual molestation going on in the kingdom. You're supposed to be sleeping with your sons and your daughters. And so, here's another one. Bishop stole money we raised for church construction to use on his own church building. The infamous building fund. It ain't even got to be the building fund, but just the money, period. And so he stole the money to build for his own church. I can understand that. You know, there should be some level of accountability when it comes down to the finances. That will make you mad. If you know that all of a sudden, you know, you find out that the money is being stolen, that's wrong. That will hurt you. But again, it should not disconnect you. He said another pastor refused to marry us and demanded that all leaders not attend our wedding. Wow. We have a lot of that going on in the church today, too. Because let's just say if the pastor wasn't in agreement with something, they have a tendency to cause people to cut other people off. And it's wrong. A person leaves the church, they're then considered as the outcast. They don't want other people to talk to them and things of that nature. Can I tell you, I've experienced this stuff firsthand. My best friend, at one point in time, in a ministry that we was in, because of the strong influence, my thing is, I had conversations with the pastor. I loved the pastor. We had a long relationship, a long history. But I said, you taught me well. And I can see just like you can see. And there's some things that ain't right. And I was told, you are 100% right, but this is my house, and I'm going to do what I want to do. And my best friend was instructed, she would not speak to me in public arenas in the church. That hurt. And she eventually came to me and apologized, but it was the influence that came from the head. Because sometimes if a wicked leader knows that you can see them, they don't want people to connect with you because you may help other people to see them, and they don't want to be exposed. But anything that is hidden will be revealed sooner or later. And a lot of things got revealed. But you will have individuals sometimes that will tell their people, don't talk to them, don't deal with them, and things of that nature. Again, We would be in the sanctuary, in public. She couldn't speak to me, but we was living in the same quarters together. Behind closed doors, we talking and everything of that nature. And it hurt me. You know, and she had to explain to me that she had to do this, but it hurt me. But I realized the depth of the manipulation of the control that was coming from the top. It's deep. But it hurt, but it didn't damage me. Did I continue to still love her? Yes, because I understood the influence that she was under. And so, somebody else said it took a white co-worker to church and he was treated like a dog with three legs. That's hurtful. That's their level of hurt. Jealousy can cause instant betrayal among clergy who are very close, especially those just starting in ministry and really love their mentors but don't understand the prophetic gifts and the power of the anointing and where God will take them because of humility. This can cause church hurt. Somebody else said being blackballed in the community and church because people didn't believe in women preachers. See, sometimes if you know that you are a woman and you're called in ministry and you get shut down because you're a woman, sometimes that could cause you hurt. But you gotta realize some people still stuck. Yep. Do what you are supposed to do. Go where you are received. Where you are not received, guess what? Kick the dust up off your feet. Sometimes we got to stop taking things so personally and realize some people do stuff out of ignorance and out of tradition, things that they've been taught. But they never study and learn for themselves. And so if grandpa and them and the next generation and after that, they never believed in women preachers and you know you got a divine call in your life to preach the word and they come against you, that's going to hurt because in your heart, you just want to do the will of the Lord. You just want to preach the word of God because you know what he's called you to do. But you got these individuals that shun you because of their ignorance. So sometimes you got to understand where a person is and not take it personal. I never forget, I'm a female pastor and I had close contact with a woman that's in, from the apostolic denomination and, you know, holiness church. It was a holiness church and she would, you know, Pastor Mitchell, let me talk to you. You know, you got so many people that, you know, follow your example. And I'm going to tell you, you know, as a woman of God, you don't need to be wearing them pants. I mean, I know you look nice and all, but you don't need to be wearing them pants. And, you know, because the Bible says that a woman shouldn't wear anything that pertaineth to a man. I just looked at it and said, and that's it. Because some stuff you don't feed into when you automatically know where they are. Especially when you know what the word says. The Bible wasn't talking about clothing. The Bible was talking about homosexuality, transgender dressing, and things of that nature. It wasn't talking about no pants. Ain't nobody had pants in biblical times. And so, I could have took that personal, but I didn't. But some people do, and it bothers them to the core. The reality is some people are more sensitive to others. But what I'm trying to tell you is if you have a correct understanding of the word of God, don't fall prey to somebody's ignorance. Know for yourself. And so somebody else said many leaders have also been hurt by the church. And sometimes that also leads them to hurt the flock. That's being bleeding. That's called leading while bleeding. And they're right. A lot of times individuals want to talk about how the pastor has hurt them. We discussed that last week, how a lot of pastors have done things. But y'all think that we don't hurt? Y'all jokers bite. The ones that we serve on a consistent basis. We have sheep bites because y'all bite. And it hurts. But guess what? God has to teach us how to handle the hurts. We have to heal from the hurts. God has a way of showing us that, guess what? You're taking this personal when it really ain't had nothing to do with you. And so the reality of it, leaders aren't exempt. We probably have more of y'all biting us than y'all have of y'all biting each other. And so, that can hurt. Leaders can be hurt too. It says, a good friend of mine had a baby out of wedlock. That ain't nothing new in the church. Can we just be for real? Even in a holiness church, you can have your skirt down to the ground, but it lifts up. It ain't never stop nobody from doing nothing. And so, a good friend of mine had a baby out of wedlock, and the church members cast my friend aside. But when the tables turned, and another member did the same thing, they were sympathetic. So that's favoritism. We, the people of God, need to know how to handle flesh situations. Because the bottom line is, saints are sexing, even though they shouldn't. You don't condone the sin. in any way, shape, form, or fashion. But you work with individuals to try to help them to get to a point where they can control their flesh instead of their flesh controlling them. I'm a pastor. I have two daughters that have both had children out of wedlock while I was pastoring. Hello? I ain't never shunned or condemned my children in any way, shape, form, or fashion. They know that mama wasn't pleased, but guess what? Neither one of them was conceived out of wedlock. I wasn't married when I had either one of them. Now, I wasn't in the Lord, but they were in the Lord. They knew it, but stuff like that happened. And so if you want to deal with things, deal with it the same across the border. Don't have favoritism for one. Get on one real bad, then somebody else that's super close to you, the same thing happened, and now you don't deal with it. That hurts. And so we have to be mindful of that. And so it says, because of that, my friend struggles with attending church because of the favoritism, hypocritical judging people of the church. And because of that situation, the young lady don't want to go to church anymore because of that hurt that she experienced. But again, people of God, you need to understand that's not everybody. That's not every church. And that's where people need to change their thinking. Because what happens is if one Christian did it, then all Christians are the same. If one leader did this to me, then all leaders are the same. No, we're not. And so, it says, more often it happens in leadership when called out one's integrities become toxic and intolerable behaviors become a stumbling block to a baby here or young in the fervent faith. And I can understand that. What he's basically saying is when you have a person in a leadership position and they do things that's out of order, how it affects those that are young in the faith, those that may be babies, it's a stumbling block. And yes, it can affect them. We discussed that. It says, when leaders or people become too preoccupied with fleshly matters, such as worldly accolades or folk having that itching desire to call themselves, not God, into ministry, it tends to divide the flock. It does stuff. A lot of people messed up in the church today because they see a lot of people standing in the pulpit, pastoring churches, they nowhere near called. They call themselves. They have a desire to be famous. They have a desire to be lifted up. It's all about them. People can see that, and it turns them off. And so, again, they can take one situation with a person and put it across the border. Somebody say, when some low-level wannabe leader, not the pastor, co-pastor, or assistant pastor, tells you that they don't know why you married the person you married and your belly is full of a baby. So they was upset, but let me tell you something. They was upset because a member, one of their brothers and sisters in the church, it wasn't the pastor, it wasn't the co-pastor, and what I'm hearing is I may have accepted it from them, but who are you to tell me something? Who are you to come at me about this situation? And so she talked about the fact, you know, they're telling them they don't know why you married the person, you know, that you married. And she was saying, basically, you know, how you gonna say that to me and I got a baby in my stomach? But let me say this first of all, being pregnant ain't a reason to get married. See, let's be for real, because I don't know the whole story, but guess what? The one that approached you probably knew something about the one that you was pregnant by and may have saw something that you didn't need to step into. But in your mind, I'm in the church, I'm pregnant, you know, the best thing we should do is go on and get married because some of us pressed and just want to have a family real bad, even when all the signs are there that we should not marry this person. So that individual had an attitude because they was addressed about the situation. Sometimes we get upset when people come to us with true stuff, with stuff that they need to. We are our brother's keeper. But that individual got upset because they was addressed about that situation. It says, when you... And that individual said that was the turning point for them 25 years ago. Do y'all see the magnitude and the depth of that hurt that is still present? But that was the turning point for them 25 years when it comes down to dealing with church and church people. That's not good at all. And so, when you have served in a ministry for years and paid your tithes faithfully, and when your season is up, and you leave the ministry, using the proper protocol and met with the leaders and they okayed it, then the pastor turns around and forbids the members to associate with you, even the individuals that you brought to the church, because they are afraid that they may lead too. It's control and manipulation, and they are 100% right. And can I tell you, unfortunately, pastors need to know how to let people go. Everybody's not going to be at your church forever. I've experienced this personally. When you have the conversation, when your leader knows the call that's on your life, they're in agreement with it. They have you before the church. They pray. We talk about it. And you tell them, when the Lord tells me to start the ministry, I will let you know. You already know this is direction. We're on the same page. But as soon as you tell them, oftentimes it now turns. Can I tell you why some leaders get upset? Because you were such a good help in the ministry. You play such a major role in the ministry, and nobody wants to lose good help, good people. And so now they become self-absorbed and take it personal instead of realizing this is somebody from your ministry that you're launching out. You should be excited about that. But I'm telling y'all, unfortunately, a lot of pastors don't know how to handle it. They don't know how to handle when people leave the church. And so people leave and they get mad, they get upset, they get hurt, and they deal with it in a negative type of way. And it shouldn't be so. My thing is, when people want to leave, all I ask is, let me know. Now, how many of y'all know that don't happen half the time? But if I've been pastoring you for 10 years, don't do what we talked about last week, the signs. You stop giving, you stop sitting in the front, you slide to the back. You missed this Sunday. You missed this Bible study. Then all of a sudden, you know, we don't see you no more. I see you. I just hope that you talk to me, but I see the progression of where you're going. That's the only thing I ask. And when people come and say that they're leaving, I ain't trying to stop them. One thing, I can say rah-rah. Rah-rah when it was time for her, when she thought it was time for her to go. I didn't agree with what she was saying, but she came to me. And even though she's back now, she still know that God ain't, that wasn't God, but that's what we there on this, okay? But we had the conversation. But I already walked into the meeting with my mind set that I'm not going to try to convince her to stay. I'm not going to tell her that God ain't telling you to do this. Let's just talk. Is there anything that I did? Is there anything that was done to you? What is there anything? Let's talk about it. But guess what? I give you my blessings. Go in peace. And guess what? When she left, did I lose contact with you? Not at all. God sent her back home, didn't he? Because she wasn't supposed to be gone. But the bottom line is, leaders need to learn how to deal with individuals leaving. And when you do it the wrong way and you talk about them and things of that nature, and that makes me so mad. Because it's as if their one decision to leave causes you to overlook all the good that they did in that ministry for years. Mm-hmm. How they served, how they was committed, how they was there, how they gave. You get to the point that you no longer can see that because you're blinded by your own hurt. And you can no longer see all the good that they've done in that ministry. And so, when the church condemns and shuns their members, that's another one. Somebody said, leaders heard as well, when my husband and I announced we were getting married, a few of the young women left the church. This is a leader. She obviously married somebody in the church, the pastor of the church. But when my husband and I announced we were getting married, a few of the young women left the church with no explanation. Y'all want me to tell you why? Probably because they thought they was going to be the one. They thought they was going to be first lady. And you met this woman, man, came to the church, ain't been there for years. And all of a sudden, I've been here for years. I've been serving. I've been doing this. I know I'm cute and all this other stuff. And you won't choose her? Where'd she come from? So now, because you had your eyes on the prize, so to say, when he takes somebody that ain't you, I'm out of here. I ain't gonna be here no more. They leave. So, and many of them left with no explanation. But guess what? One of them did say it wasn't fair that I got a second opportunity to get married because I was previously divorced. The woman was upset because the one he married was married before. That marriage didn't work for whatever reason. She got divorced. And in this individual's mind, is you got the nerve. You're getting a second chance, and this one probably never been married. And so they mad because you're getting a second chance at marriage. Some people have a problem when people get divorced in church. Some individuals will not let individuals serve anymore in different positions because they say the husband of one wife, and they can never do certain things again because they got divorced. That's foolishness. God don't like divorce. Trust me. I don't promote divorce or anything of that nature. But how many of y'all know it is not the unpardonable sin? It's not the unpardonable sin. And it does happen. And so the females went running. When church condemns and shuns their members, Christendom, period. That's what somebody said. Ain't no Christ. It's been a famine in the land for a long time. He said basically that's what hurts Christendom, the church. What he said. The church is off, but guess what? It's biblical. The Bible talks about the great falling away that must take place before he comes. We still have an assignment to reach as many lost souls as we possibly can. But don't be surprised at the stuff that you see. It says, a pastor shared this. I don't believe the church hurts people, but people hurt people who happen to be in the church. But the truth be told, there are some debts, there are some things that people deal with, the same situations in their families, on their jobs, but they don't leave there. They said some of the stuff you do in the church, you get upset, you want to leave, but you go through the same stuff on your job with your family, you don't leave there. There's a higher level of expectancy placed on people and leaders in the church, and it should be, that is not associated with other areas. I feel that when we are hurt in church, we handle it the same way. If we handle it the same way we would if we find ourselves in the same situation elsewhere, meaning deal with it, work through it. It says we had to also realize that all people in the church, we had to realize that the people in the church are often wounded and damaged. Somebody said, you know what? I was treated some kind of way by some of this so-called leadership in my family's church from childhood through my teen years. Once I was turned away from church because I wore pants as a 10-year-old girl. And I didn't even mention to them that it was wintertime and we walked to church. Another example is that they allowed their children to bully me and my little cousin, and when it was brought to their attention, they looked the other way. I will say that I was jaded from a young girl, and still, this is a grown woman with a daughter of her own, but what took place at the age of 10 has messed with her. It says I was jaded from a young girl, and I still have residual hurt. But I press on for my husband and for my daughter. That's deep. From a young girl that has caused her to have issues all along. And again, with that type of hurt, when you do go to a church, you're looking for flaws. You're looking for things because you already expected it because of what you experienced in the past. And it says, and this one is real. All of them real. But I've discussed this to a degree, but it says, what really hurts is when you are married and some other woman messes with your man and she knows that he is married and turns around and has kids by him and they act like they didn't do anything wrong. I've seen a lot of that. For real. And I know individuals that are still messed up to this day because of things like that. Majorly wounded. That will hurt anybody. That will hurt the wife that is married to the man. And yet there's other women in the midst of the crowd that's getting pregnant by him and having children. Y'all forgot Jim Jones? He was an interesting character, like a lot of pastors that I've seen that was involved with a lot of the women in the church. Now I'm going to say this. Women have always been the downfall of men for a long time. You have a lot of female leaders today leading the church. But you don't find a lot of women that fall in that particular way. But it's something about a man that stands in this position, a man with power. Women are drawn to the anointing of God on a man's life, even when he looked like Shabba Ranks. Oh. I'm telling you the truth. I'm telling you the truth. Can I tell you? The anointing is like being intoxicated off of alcohol. Because again, you know when you twist it off of alcohol, you know, you don't really see that well.
Chanel number 9, the potion, the love potion.
The love potion. Have you tripping? And so, you know, you get sober and you look up at the person that you were, oh my God, I came home with this. Because now you're not intoxicated anymore. The anointing has a tendency to intoxicate women in the church. For the man that stands at the pulpit. And if you don't have a strong man of God in this position, he is bound to fall. Because just like at the concerts, when the women would throw things up on the stage, let me tell you, the women in the congregation is throwing things at the man of God. It's nothing for a man of God to go to a conference and somebody at that conference to have a chick waiting for him at the hotel room when he get back. Or you have groupies in the church. And so, that's why it's so important that as leaders, when you take this position, that you have been processed to the point that you have killed your flesh. Because you would deal with all kinds of temptations that come with this position of power. Financial temptation, lustful temptations, all kinds of temptations. But you need to be ready to take this position. Because if you're not ready, this position will take you down. Because you will get caught up destroying the lives of many and mess with the minds of many. And so, somebody else said when you question the actions of your pastor and the pastor uses the pulpit and influence to humiliate you before the entire church out of his or her own insecurities. As leaders, we aren't supposed to use this pulpit for that purpose. You got to make sure that you're hearing from God when you mount the pulpit. Again, a hurt person will think that you're preaching about them because of where they are. When you are speaking what the Lord has given you. But the devil will sit right there in the church next to them on the left side. And tell them, you know they talking about you. They did this whole message just for you. Boo, you're not that important. I'm sorry, you're just not that important. Pastors have to hear from the word of God. And how many of y'all know whenever the message goes forward, there's somebody's toes that's getting stepped on. Somebody's, if it's a true word. Let me tell you this, if it's a word and you're doing something that ain't right, that ain't lining up, and it's talked about, you're going to feel it. You're going to feel it. If that ain't your issue, it's going to brush right over you. But don't think that leaders are in a position where every night they're seeking the Lord. Lord, what would you let me hit to preach to Q this morning? I know everybody else is going to be there, but God, I want to speak a word for Q. No. But you do. You have some that will abuse the pulpit. One individual said, I jump from church to church and seeking and finding flaws. Now I'm in a church with my pastor, and my pastor told me the same people you see in church are the same people that you see on the street. Somebody said cliques, lack of honesty, integrity, character, favoritism, when people gossip about you, when leadership lies, when the congregation and the pastor intentionally attack you because you're different. Different as in your understanding, your purpose, your calling, your anointing, and also different And you, the person, knowing how to act in church settings really comes to a service and not acting like everyone else does. Sometimes that's a whole nother issue right there. See, I can read in between stuff. You know, and so if you're a person that you in a church and you always feel like nobody understands your anointing, people hate your anointing, they don't respect your call and different things. No, you got some other issues going on. It's what's going on inside of you. Because in the church, we want all people to flow in the anointing. In the church, we know all of us are different. I always tell people always want to say, I'm just different. No, you ain't. Well, let me say this. Not different the way you think you are. See, because you're thinking you're different on a whole nother level, and that's why people don't like you, because you're just different, because you're so anointed, you're anointed and all this other stuff. The bottom line is, ain't nobody in the church the same. We all different. We all different. No two people are the same. In some situations, you got to just tell a person, get over yourself, because that's all you. Get over yourself. And so, excommunication for things like having a child before marriage. Being offended, passed over, not accepted in the church. And then again, spiritual parenting or spiritual molestation. So, again, some of these individuals have shared things that have hurt them that are legitimate, while others reveal a level of immaturity on the part of an individual. And some folks, many individuals, come into the kingdom of God hurt, broken, suffering from rejection, and are sensitive and perceive everything from this slant. Either way you look at it, the fact remains that many are hurting and in need of major healing and deliverance. Hurt cannot be avoided, people of God. You cannot avoid it. Jesus said offenses will come. And so we have to understand that. We just need to learn how to handle our hurts. We need to address matters, people of God, sooner than later. The word of God says, be angry and do not sin, and do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil. If your sister or brother has done something to offend you, guess what? Don't allow 2 months to go by, 3 months to go by, because during that time, who is talking to you and ministering to you? The devil. The devil. If you take the opportunity and do like the word of God says and go to them, you may find out that it was a simple misunderstanding. But yet you've been walking around bitter and angry and upset because you've been just playing with the thoughts in your own head. So if you're bothered by something, address it. Go to the individual. I like the New Living Translation. It says, for anger gives a foothold to the devil. The devil loves anger. And he will use that to divide people. And so the longer you avoid a matter and talk to everyone except the one you have the issue with, because that's what happens, we get hurt, we have an issue with a person, but we want to go and talk to everybody. And guess what? We're talking to everybody about it, but we ain't trying to get counsel. You just running your mouth about what took place. Sometimes you want to talk to other people because you want them to get mad at the person that hurt you. Causing division. Come on, baby. Pass the mic. I said, I done went through all this and ain't nobody said nothing.
Amen. I'm
hitting it on the head. All right, come on.
Well, sometimes you can go to the pastor or whatever and tell them the situation that's going on, but if the pastor is still operating in flesh, it can cause more damage than it do good. And I'm saying that from a personal experience because I went to my old pastor and told him that I was hurt. Because church is supposed to be a safe haven. That's why the expectations are so high. You go through what you go through in the world to come into the safe haven, to get healed, restored, and all of those things like that. It's not that we put a lot of expectations on our leaders. We're just going by what the Word of God says, especially if you grew up in it. So when you go to church, it's supposed to be your safe haven. It's supposed to be a place that you can be safe until you're fully nurtured to handle things on your own.
What does safe mean? Okay, let's talk about what you mean by safe. Because you say it's supposed to be a safe haven. What does that mean?
To me, it means like protection.
Okay, so protection meaning that you should come be able to come into the church and nothing hurts you?
No, I'm not saying that. Don't get me wrong.
Okay, break it down.
You're going to come in. You may be coming in a hurting state, but you've heard all of your life that, you know, Jesus will help you. Jesus is working out for you, you know, go to the church and you'll get better and all that stuff like that. So it's a place where you can get better, a place that you can be able to grow and all that stuff like that. So when you come to the church and those things are not happening like that, you're like, okay, well, what's really going on?
When you say they're not happening like that, what, with your other brothers and sisters in the church?
Or just leadership.
Okay, because certain things should be right with leadership, but again, when you're dealing with your brothers and sisters in church,
everybody's not on the same level, so you can't expect the same thing, which is fine. But I'm talking about the leadership perspective.
Okay.
So right. When you go to, so the situation happened at the church where one of the leaders was in a homosexual relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew of it. And if you run in a church and you're supposed to be against homosexuality by the word says and all that stuff like that, you're going to tell your pastor because you don't want other people to look at them like they're funny. Like, well, how you got these gay people up here running and doing stuff, but the Bible speaks against that. Mm-hmm. So when I had told the pastor, and it was hard for me to tell him because I was really cool with the guys that was doing what they was doing, but I didn't want their leadership or the church just to come down because of scandal, because I cared.
Mm-hmm.
So when I told him, he told me, you need to worry about your own salvation. Worry about your own sins before you try to come for somebody else's.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like, on that note, it was like, okay, wow. So you sit up here and preach and tell me what I'm supposed to do out of the Bible, but then I'm telling you something that I see and I know personally, and you just gonna sit up here and tell me to worry about my own sins? Like, what was the whole point?
That was
a hurtful situation, and it made me be like, I'm done with it. Like, I can honestly say, even sitting through this whole thing, I still have some residue from church hurt. It's hard for me to trust people, especially in church.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I put up a wall, and it's just like, I don't have time for it. And it's not that I have expectations on church people, whatever, but it's just like, I'm so close to just walking away from it all. And it's not that I know I'm not called, and it's not that I know I'm not anointed, but I don't have time to open my heart up again to constantly get hurt. I'm in church hurt since I was 8 years old. Grown people talking about me, belittling me. They saying that I was different and unique, and instead of covering me and loving on me, they put grown expectations on me. They made me, you know, like a billboard of ridicule. They didn't want their children hanging around me, and there was nothing that I did that was wrong. So you constantly growing up into this, and you going to different churches and dealing with it, and the people telling you to get over it, but you know the true way. You know what God says. You know what is right. So because you don't want to be faulty like everybody else, it's a problem. And then you get into your own self, and you start doing what you want to do, where you fit in, and you're feeling comfortable because you're in your lane and your safe haven, so you think.
All right, bring it down.
I'm sorry.
Look, she riled up right now, but let me tell you.
I'm sorry.
No. I know what you're actually saying, and let me say this. When they hear you, look at me. It's one of the look at me moments. They hear you. And sometimes when you are an individual that you've dealt with so much church hurt, you sometimes have to do what you and I do. You come to me. We talk. I have all my notes. I bring out all the points to help you to see that what you perceived as one way wasn't what they were necessarily doing. But because you were young and you didn't understand sometimes them protecting you, you felt like they didn't want you to be you. And so a person's perception of a thing can cause them to have deeper hurts than what really was the intention. That's why people that are hurt need to get counseling, because again, people can hear what you just said, but some stuff legit,
what?
Some stuff not.
What?
Come on, give it a mic.
No, even in the midst of that, I don't walk around as a scorned person. So let me put that in there. Let me finish my disclaimer. You know, Pastor, look at me, got me. I don't.
You don't walk around as a scorned person. You just got walled up.
Right. I just hit.
Can't nobody get in. Go ahead. Come on, younger lady.
So what I'm saying is what I've learned to do is I've learned to take that hurt and not walk around bitter and stuff like that. And that's why I start just because. You see what I'm saying? I do stuff for people just because. Not because I'm looking for validation or anything like that, but I know what it felt like to be in a hurting place. So it's like, even though you go through church hurt and you did what you did with, you had to ask God to show me, what can I do with this pain that I had or that I'm trying to get over? So, you know, we give back, do Thanksgiving drives and all that stuff like that. And when I get to a point, you know, in with church and stuff like that, I can be able to reach church hurt kids. You see what I'm saying? But you can't prematurely go into something if you're not totally healed from it. So because I know I still have some healing to do, that's not an area that I touch.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? So even though I have some cons on it, it's some pros to it as well. You learn from it, and then you grow from it, and then you move forward. And I still, you know, say hi and bye to the people that hurt me or whatever, because at the end of the day, I know that God got me. But at that point in time, I didn't know that God had me.
Amen. So, pass it to the young lady behind you. I want her to get the mic. I'll get you too. Let me just say this final thing to you. When you go into a church and you're dealing with a pastor because you see stuff, prophets need to understand this. Now, prophets see stuff that oftentimes other people don't see. Prophets a lot of time can see the sin, like she could see the homosexual mess and all the stuff that was going on. So she did the right thing, because there's a prophet in the church. And the bottom line is, she was young, she's still being developed, but I know what's on her. Amen. And so what she did was she went to her leader and she shared with her leader. What prophets have to understand is, once you give it to the leader, it's out of your hand. What they do with it is on them. They may respond to what you tell them, or they may not respond. You can't allow yourself to get mad and upset because you feel like, I see this, I know this, I brought this to you, now you should do something. Because sometimes you don't know how the pastor is actually working with those that you see it on. So I know there was a lot of stuff in that place. So it wasn't a lot of working that was going on with some stuff. But I'm just saying this for those who operate as prophets. You got to understand, you can go to your pastor sometime. Reveal to your pastor what it is that you see. In your mind, you feel as though they should handle it a certain way. They don't handle it the way you think they should. Now you get upset. Now you feel like, I ain't going to say nothing no more. That's not what you do. As a prophet, you release the word. And then allow the one who has been given the responsibility to shepherd that house to do what they need to do with what you've released. Yes, ma'am.
I experienced church hurt on a really deep level. And today is actually my first time being in a church in 7 months. And trying really hard to not become that bitter person, because God's been too good to me. Mm-hmm. Like, all my life, even when I couldn't keep myself, he kept me.
Mm-hmm.
And I just wanted to just say, like, I don't want to be a bitter person, but church hurt is so real. It's like nothing I've ever experienced, because when you come from the world, people in the world, they just keep it 100 with you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But people in the church, they hide behind their self-righteousness and their religion. And, you know, I was going through a very tough experience with my daughter. My daughter is she's 19 years old, and she had a baby out of wedlock, you know, all of that. And it almost destroyed our family. Just because her boyfriend died, and then she went through, like, depression. It was crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And she moved out to go live with her dad, who's a Muslim. So I'm over here, like, freaking out.
Mm-hmm.
And I had missed a couple of Sundays, but really it was just, it didn't have nothing to do with the church. It was more like I was really dealing with some stuff. But then one weekend, my daughter came over to visit me. I hadn't seen her in a while, and I decided I wasn't going to go to church that Sunday. Well, my pastor texted me. And he was like, you're supposed to be a leader in the church. Why you not in church? Y'all, that's the last conversation I ever had with him. He never called again, never sent me an email, a text, to this day. I haven't heard from him. And it just makes me question, like, my purpose. Were those things real? Where am I? Why am I here? But I do, I've been praying about this and asking God, send me to a church. I need a shepherd. I need godly counsel. I need these things. And for whatever reason, I always see her on Facebook. And even last week when you did the first part of this teaching, I had a check mark next to those 10 things that you was reading off. Everything that I did, I had a check mark. When shifting the spirit, there's a shifting in the seating. That jumped at me because I used to be at the front and then I was at the back. And it's just been a very hurtful time, but I just wanted to just give God the praise that I pushed through, because I had told Jackie, I was like, we're going to church tomorrow. But I tell y'all, this morning, it was kind of raining and it was like 100 reasons that I wanted to call her and say, I'm not going to scoop you up. But I literally got into my bathroom, I closed the door, I looked in the mirror, and I was like, this that push people be talking about.
Yes.
I pushed my way there because I really,
amen.
I just needed this today. I needed your teaching. You are just an amazing woman of God. And
thank you.
Just your usher, your greeter, she was so warm. And you know, it's a good vibe in here. I feel a lot of love in this place, and it gives me hope that not all churches are the same.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm just here to serve the devil notice. Like, I'm not going to become that.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. That is an excellent place to be, because you're determined. Because what you're saying is, I'm hurt, and I'm admitting that I'm hurt. But I don't want to be a bitter person. Amen. And I love God. I love God. I love God. I love God. Only reason I say I love God is because, you know, the way God deals with me sometimes, I just look at people and he just starts speaking to me about different things. And like I said, even the service this weekend, Thursday and Friday, with so many people there that was hurt. And I just had a brief interaction with you right there, and God began to speak to me about you. And he said, I need to talk to you more, because there's so much more going on that you wouldn't even imagine. And so for now to hear you speak, I'm like, I don't doubt God, but I'm like, okay, I already knew it. Okay. But so I'm happy that you're here. Amen. And we will talk more. Amen. Yes, sir.
I quit going to church because I was church hurt, and I didn't go to church for almost 10 years. And to me, being here is like Black History Month for me, because I've been here 2 years.
Yes.
And I'm like, you know, the last church I was with was almost 2 years, but then that situation happened, I'll be quick. So I came here, and before I came here, it was like, okay, well, you can watch this church service on TV, but they can't help you. You can send them your money, they can't help you. They're way out of Texas. They really don't, I don't mean disrespect, but they care who you are. They got your money. So I said, okay, I'll go to church. There's a church right behind you. There's no reason to go any place else. You got one right next door. What's your excuse? And then I came in and I joined. I've been here 2 years.
Amen.
So I love you, Pastor. Love you, Deacon. Love you all.
Amen.
And Angelina is okay.
Amen. Pass it back to Rob. And one of the things that I know, look at me, Q. One of the things that I do know is because when we was over at D.C. at Overseer Howard's Church, that's when God really put in my spirit how he's going to use you, as you just said, to help those with church hurt. But you have to first get healed from it. And I know that's part of your testimony, because you will be able to even help people who have had genuine hurts, as well as be able to bring stuff out and say, I thought that too, but let me show you where their heart really was. And so God is doing what he's doing. Amen. I know what you know, how you feel and don't want to be bothered, but you come. And you were part, and you even stepped up and joined. So guess what? We ain't worried about it. We got you. Amen.
Yeah.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. I had wrote my question down earlier.
Yes, ma'am.
But I was waiting for a pause, you know. But I wanted to know, how do you go about helping one change their mindset
that all churches are not the same.
But first of all, just showing. One of the greatest things that you could do is be that true living example. When I think about the vision and the mission of this church, is that it's my desire that we exemplify what it means to be Christ-like by the way we live. That's our motto. Because I said, God, I don't want us to be a church that's full of hypocrites. I don't want us to be a group of people that's constantly turning people off. And so I'm seeing something flashing. All right, that's your phone. I'm like, something flashing down here. Anyway, I don't want us to be individuals that are hypocrites. So the best thing that we could do is just show them. Because guess what? People don't want to hear what you got to say. They don't want to hear it. Because a lot of times if they already hurt and got messed up ways of thinking, your words ain't going to say nothing. They have to see it. And trust me, if they hurt, they're watching you like a hawk. And again, the way they're watching you can sometimes blind them from what they really need to see. But as God work on them and you begin to pray for them, that wall will eventually come down. So live it. People of God, let's purpose not to be an individual that causes other people to fall away from God. We can't, again, and we got to remember, we hurt people knowingly and unknowingly. So just because this is the church, just because this is the safe haven, for real, we're people with issues on different levels. And we sometimes hurt the people that we love. Come on, baby.
I experienced church hurt when I was and this was my first time actually joining the church. And I'm young, I'm only 21, so.
Okay.
It was my first time actually joining the church. When I was younger, I never went to church. My family wasn't big on going to church. We kind of just like lived our lives. So my experience was kind of different. I didn't let it really bother me too much, but it bothered her. So when it bothered her, it actually bothered me.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like I was pregnant,
mm-hmm.
and I didn't have nowhere to go. I didn't have nowhere to stay. And, you know, they always say when you come to the church is supposed to help you mm-hmm. with that stuff. Like, you know, if you're in the body of church and you belong to the church, those are things that a church is supposed to help you with. Well, the problem was that the only person that was helping me was her, not the pastor. Not anybody. It was just her. So it was like, it made me, when she left, it kind of made me feel like, oh, I don't want to be there no more, because it was just her doing everything. Like, I was here off the strength of her. I came to church off the strength of her.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like,
she actually ended up being homeless, and I remember that day like it was yesterday, because I was arguing with God the whole day. Like, she can't come live with us. Me and we just got married,
mm-hmm.
like, you know, but she came. And I remember,
give her the mic. So
I remember early on in ministry, I was not very I didn't have the heart of a servant. Because if I had to give somebody a ride, I would murmur and complain like the sisters in the Bible. I think it was Martha. I think, but I would give him a ride, but it didn't come. So I start checking myself, and I was like, Lord, give me the heart. I want to serve, like, for real. I don't want to be like that. And this girl came to live with us, and I ain't getting no support from the church, not financial. I wasn't looking for that. I was looking for guidance, prayer, something that would fill me up so I could encourage her. And that wasn't happening. And I feel like she's been assigned to me. And I don't have a pastor. I don't know how to help her spiritually. Because that's what she needs the most.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I care about her as an individual, but I care about her salvation and her soul.
Mm-hmm.
It's important to me.
Mm-hmm.
But if I'm lacking, how can I help her? And those things are very hurtful. Because the word of God tells us that, you know, a lot of times churches are always looking for, like, they want to help people. But they overlook the people that God sent right to the house.
Mm-hmm.
They're
mm-hmm.
in there. They're
mm-hmm.
right there with you.
Right.
And you can't even start with them because
right.
you're so busy about going outside.
just to make a name for yourself, just so you can show our church doing this. The competition in ministry is past, is deep.
It's off the chain.
And it's discouraging.
It can be, but you had more in you than what you knew. And that's what attracted her to you. I always tell people, sometimes we're the only Jesus that a person will see.
Right.
And she saw the love of God in you. And that's what drew her to you. And that's what people need, especially when they're hurting and going through. And so sometimes you may not have the deep things to really, you know, give them like you want. But guess what? Give them what you got, because it got her. And trust God to do the rest. But that's what people need. And sometimes what happens, and we miss it in the church, is that one word over there, discipleship. That's all that is. See, because she didn't connect it to you, and it's just your responsibility to disciple her. See, as a pastor, I can't disciple everybody. I pastor everybody. I can't disciple everybody. That's why Jesus, throughout the multitude, he had the 12 that he personally discipled. But there was a whole bunch of people that was there in the multitude. Because discipleship takes time. You have to deal with them one-on-one, pour into, talk to, spend time with them, things of that nature, to learn about them, to help them to overcome the things. And so that's all that is, and that's a major missing component in the church, discipleship. People too busy. They don't have the time. You feel like they're not there to help you. Guess what? That's your assignment. She's your assignment.
And I love her. I love her like a daughter.
Amen.
I love her like a daughter.
Amen. Deacon James, you got something else, Brenner? Come on, no, give it to Deke real quick, because he ain't said nothing yet. You said something. I knew, and the reason we just did the prayer and the two songs earlier is because I knew this was going to be interactive, and I knew this was going to be longer. We're getting ready to wind down in a minute, but this is a serious topic. Go ahead.
I've never personally experienced church hurt, but I've witnessed things that I can, when I think about what I've seen and witnessed, I could justify for being hurt. But one thing I realized is that the way my foundation was a foundation where relationship, personal relationship was pushed. So I didn't really start off. You know, a lot of people in ministry start off religious to where they start off in a ministry, or their foundation is, you know, they put so much, they put the pastor and the leader on a pedestal, and the church that they're in or the ministry they're in, they're not, the leadership is not really pushing them to know God for themselves, or to, even we're in a church where our pastor wants us to study the word, want to know God for ourselves. It's about relationship, this, that, and the other. And a lot of times, people are in ministry for a while before they realize that it's more than what they've been told. There's more. They discover that this personal relationship is what's the real deal. I even think about Mother Folks. You know, she talked about for years she was in the ministry, but she felt like there's got to be more than this. A lot of people go through that, you know, and sometimes when they're coming up, you know, I know that a lot of people, you know, that's older and been in ministry for a while, you know, they come to church and the Bible's right there in the pew, and that's basically, they told them what scripture to go to, and then that's it. Whatever the pastor say, pastor say. But what is God saying to you? You know what I mean? And a lot of times, people don't discover that this relationship thing is number one. It's not what you just, it's not just coming to church or whatever. So when they put the pastor or a leadership on a pedestal, when something goes wrong, it devastates them. It devastates them because they don't really know that the word said, nothing shall separate me from the love of God. And when things come our way, it devastates us to a point where that's all we knew. That's how we saw ministry. That's all that we know. So we say, I can't do this no more. And I'm not trying to say that the hurt is not real. People go through real hurt, it's real. But I just, you know, I really believe that we really have to focus on our relationship with God, and that has to be number one. And we have to know that the things that we go through, nothing should separate us from that love between you and Jesus Christ. People are going to hurt you, no matter what title they have, no matter what they do. But we have to know, we have to, that's what we have to put on a pedestal, is that our relationship with God. And I just, you know, I just wanted to say that because it's like, I'm hearing everything, and I realize that I've had justification in my life for being hurt, but I thank God that I didn't put the emphasis on the leaders or the people that I saw or people that I even stood next to, people that I've stood on platforms with that have served God wholeheartedly, and now they've fallen away. And I'm still doing it. I'm still standing for God. And it's not because of I'm so great. It's just because I have a personal relationship with him. But I have definitely have justification for being hurt. And I think nobody is exempt. You know, nobody from the pastor to the congregation, nobody is exempt from being hurt. But it's about how you respond to certain things and your personal relationship with him. Amen.
And that's what's key, having a personal relationship with God. And we have to understand, oftentimes when people first get saved and they come into the body of Christ, they do normally connect to a person. And that person at that time is usually their pastor or whoever it is that is actually leading them and guiding them. So that becomes a voice that is very familiar with them. And so what happens, God will shift things sometimes in that relationship because God doesn't want you to become dependent upon that person. Sometimes you need a vessel that you can physically connect with to get you rooted and grounded. But what happens is a lot of people begin to see that person as God and not God. And so God wants you to be able to know that it's him, it's his voice. They're just the vessel that he's actually using. And that's what most people have problems with. When people have fallen away, it's because they have put so much trust in God and not in, they put so much trust in man and not in God. What happens is when you do have your own relationship with God, what's happening in the church today with people is that they are taking their own relationship with God and using that to justify why they don't need to connect with other people. See, because now it's like, I have my relationship with God. Yes, people hurt me, and I ain't worrying about people because me and God are good. Well, for real, they're using that as a way to separate and stay disconnected and tell you, I'm still good with God. I still, you know, have a relationship. I still pray. I just don't go to church. Well, guess what? If you have a real relationship with God, then you will go to church.
That's right.
Because you will understand God's word. And so people are taking stuff and twisting it. I see you. People are taking stuff and twisting it. Come on.
Because you're saying everything that, okay, for one, when the person said on your feed, you know, you go to work every day, you get hurt by people, blah, 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 blah. Well, that's how I thought before I went through the hurt. And like I said, it was a lesson. But also, I was sitting here and I was thinking, you know, you think about most of the people that have been hurt in church. Sometimes it's just something that's, it's a greater attack on to stop you from doing what you're called to do.
Oh, yes.
And if it can get you to get out of your place and out of the church, you don't have to worry about it. One of the things you just said is one of the things that the enemy spoke to me. And when I wrote it, God said, that's hurt talk. Because I said, I don't have to go to church to do what I need to do. And I was just I don't have to go to church anymore. God called me. The church ain't got nothing to do with what God called me to. I can go outside and do, I'm an event. I can do this outside the church. I said that. But that was hurt talk. Mm-hmm. And that hurt talk leads you to more bitterness. Mm-hmm. And it's a separation. But if you allow that separation to take you out of the place where you need to go to get the guidance to get, because we're not strong enough to get to the next place all the time. Mm-hmm. And that's why fellowship is there. Mm-hmm. And if you real think, if you think about it, like Deacon was saying, but the real hurt comes from those that you love the most. Mm-hmm. And I put so much love inside of my church and my church family that was one of the things God had to pull me back from. Because you love them so much from my previous church and so on. So I just sit here and I think, you know what, if we are, if we can get to the point where we can be strong enough to say, yeah, I was hurt, but I get through it. You get, yeah, they said something, but you, I got to get through it, because the relationship is not with the people in the church, truly. It's with the God that's inside of you, that you need to get closer to him. And that hurt is not a is not an all to the all, end to the all. You know, that hurt is an elevation. You can either elevate from the hurt, or you can just fall to the wayside. And I believe that when God allows that to happen, because everything has to be allowed, when God allows that to happen, you have to make a decision who you really, really in your heart serve. Mm-hmm. Because when I decided, okay, I'm getting away from this, I didn't say I was getting away from God. And I didn't say I was leaving the church. I said I was getting away from the hurt. And that was my thing, is to withdraw from the hurt. Mm-hmm. It's a real thing. And if you've never been through it, I pray that you never, ever go through it, because it's a real thing. It can make or break a real soldier for God.
Yes, it can. Yes, it can. Okay, this is the one that I didn't share that was very pertinent. It says, my hurt is when a pastor by the name of so-and-so stands in the holy place and preaches knowing he is a child molester. That's my hurt. It makes me sick to see people believing this demon is a man of God. He beat my mother also to death, almost to death, and has never apologized. That hurts. Church is not for phony players. It's for people that want to really change. And the reality of it is, sometimes you have leaders and people who have done things and they are still in position, as I said on the last time, trust me, God deals with them. He will deal with them. Amen. But I know it hurts for a person to know the depth of what they've done, and yet they're still standing there and people are believing them. Do y'all realize it took the people... When you go, because, I mean, we have a lot of Jim Jones ministries out here. I can't, you know, all of those people that was following that man, believing that man, some got out because the light came on. But there were many that drank the Kool-Aid and died because they was that deep under the influence. Unfortunately, when you have spirits that are in high places, in positions of leadership, you will have people sitting there that don't know the truth, don't know what's really going on with that, because they're blinded by the dazzle that comes from that manipulating spirit. But God will deal with them. And so, bottom line, church hurt is something that we can't ignore. It's something that we have to deal with. We need to confront things and shut down the conflicts, but most people don't like confrontation. And so you have to get to a point, as I said, hurt can't be avoided. You need to know that. Second major component to healing from hurts is forgiving. You have to be willing to forgive. And as long as you're holding on to unforgiveness, you are hurting yourself. You're keeping yourself in bondage. And so there are a lot of bitter saints who have not really forgiven people in their hearts. They said it out their mouth, but they don't mean it in their heart. And some people actually feel justified for not forgiving certain people. A person can feel like, you molested me. I shouldn't have to forgive you. No, you still need to forgive, because that forgiveness is for you.
Yes.
Please understand, forgiveness is the act of excusing or pardoning another person in spite of their slights, their shortcomings, and their errors. Listen to this. Anyone can hold a grudge, but it takes a person with character to forgive. When you forgive, you release yourself from a painful burden. Forgiveness doesn't mean what happened was okay. And it doesn't mean that person should still be welcome in your life. It just means you have made peace with the pain and are ready to let it go. Yes, ma'am.
It's the trusting God part that's difficult for people to forgive or to let go of things, trusting that God deals with everybody. And you need to, people need to see it. They want to be able to see you fall. They want to be able to see you receive punishment, but you got to trust it. You know, because even... I think about myself, and people don't understand, like, well, how can you just be okay with, I was molested as a child, but I've forgiven that person? because I know he has to answer to God about it. Mm-hmm. And on the real, there's nothing I can physically do to him to discipline him the way that God can. But that bondage, will it'll keep you if you don't learn to forgive people in that way.
Yes.
Seriously.
Yes.
And you just have to trust that you gotta, I gotta answer to God for stuff. Everybody has to.
Yes.
But we wanna always feel, we want them to feel that hurt that we felt. Even in a church with the church hurt thing, you want them to, you know, why should I forgive you? Why should I, you know, let this thing go? But you don't know what that person might be dealing with in their inner being, and God might be dealing with them on that they've done to you.
Right.
Honestly.
And think about it. You can pass it over. And think about it, and we get ready to wind down. But that hurt is so real. That's why David said, let death seize them.
Yeah.
Let them go down alive into hell. For the wickedness is their dwellings and among them. I mean, he wanted to see some stuff seriously take place. But we got to leave it to God. God will deal with it. We may not ever see it, but trust me, God sees everything and knows all.
And we also got to be, ask God to help us to be spiritually mature when, if he do allow us to see that come afflictions and stuff come back on the person. And it's not always, you know, because of us. But I just gotta be honest. Some people from my childhood church, the ones who, you know, did whatever they did, they recently got caught up in that Baltimore City police officer scandal. That was their family. And they was going around, you know, asking for prayer, which you should do, even though, you know, your husband stole all this money and all this stuff. So my sister had called me, and I was sitting there, and she was like, did you hear? And I was like, no, what you talking about? She was like, oh, so-and-so husband, he was the police officer in the corruption. And I was like, really? You know, because I'm like the church girl out the family or whatever. But I can't lie, my flesh was like,
she was happy.
Oh, I was like, well, look at you. Lovely time friend. And then it's a 20-something years, Lord, but you're always on time. My God.
And she just being honest.
So I'm saying that even when you do trust God in those situations, just humble your flesh a little bit. The child was all over his screenshots. But see, the thing about it is this. Even though that happened is very unfortunate because it's a scandal all over, you can't allow the enemy to use you as a tool to spread gossip.
Come on.
And be confusion. Oh, did you know so-so? And this is right when I got off of Facebook. So I had people emailing me like, Kim, did you see Monique Cosmos? I was like, what? So I had to, I'm sorry. But anyway, they was reaching out to me. So what I'm saying is when those type of situations happen, and God do allow certain things to happen to your enemies, you still have to be in a position to pray for them. Me and Desire actually prayed for that family. Everybody can't handle scandal. Everybody can't handle hurt. But if you handled hurt, you got to pray that God gives them peace and strength that they won't succumb to what everybody else has to say about them.
Amen.
So that's all.
Amen. And she's going to say, but she got to say, and then I'm going to bring it to a close.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Recently, my father had sex with me from the time that I was 8 to the time I was 16. So recently, I'm in this program, and it's a housing program, and I had told the director there, and she had to report it because it was her job. And a couple of days later, the investigator called me, and I have a little brother. He's almost 14, and still lieves with them. I have nieces and nephews that still live with them. So she asked me, did I want to press charges? And I thought about it, and I was like, I was stuck between the two. Like, do I want to press charges or not? And some told me don't press charges, and I didn't press charges. And because I know that he's in his heart and his mind, it's fighting, it's hurting. Because when I had my son, he did show up to the hospital. When he seen my face, he looked so scared. He looked scared. He looked terrified. Like, something did to somebody did something to him. Like, so, I mean, I understand that God is going to handle him, and I'm not worried about it. I've forgiven him. I let it go, and I'm moving on with my life, because if I didn't let it go, I wouldn't be able to take care of my son.
Right. Amen. 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 And what she's experienced is what so many people have experienced. Mm-hmm. So many people have experienced it. And in some situations, I mean, in a situation like that, you have to be led by God. I would say in a situation like that, seek counsel, advice, godly advice as far as what you should do or shouldn't do. But every situation is different. Sometimes the thought constantly goes through your mind of all the other people that they could still be affecting in that way. You know, so it's one of those things a lot of people go through. And thank God you are able to actually deal with that. And I pray that, you know, since all of that has taken place with you, you're only 21 years old and it went on for many, many years, there's something that can influence and affect you in everything that you do in your life. And sometimes you have to get healed and counseling and things of that nature from all that occurred from that situation. That's the type of stuff I even talk about in the book that I wrote about why do I keep falling, dealing with molestation and things of that nature. So let me close this up, y'all. Thirdly, for deep hurts, especially from those who have suffered spiritual abuse, because we know it's important to admit your role you may have played in a situation. It's important to forgive. But sometimes for those who have suffered spiritual abuse and those sexual abuse in the church at the hand of your leader or someone else, get professional help. Get counseling. We don't often get help that we need as a people, because we are so prideful, and that's why we be messed up for years. Get professional help, because when is somebody that you deeply trusted, even for the baby girl to say, like with her dad, your dad is not a person that you are ever supposed to look at as somebody that you are sexually intimate with for years. You don't ever look at your mother, you don't ever look at your father and think about them being your lover. This is the person that's supposed to love you, nurture you, protect you, and care for you. But yet, because of their own demons, they do things to you that affect you. That's nothing to brush over. You can say, Lord, I forgive them, but you still need help. Because it manifests throughout the years in so many different ways. And then finally, remember, people are people. You have to remember that, y'all. People are people. And so, remember, people are not always easy to deal with, but we can't and should not avoid them. We're on this earth with people. And so those who try and have mastered seclusion and having walls up in the midst of interacting with people are miserable. Meaning, you could be going through walls up, you're there physically, but you're not mentally. You have a wall up and you aren't happy. And so we are not called to avoid people, we are called to what? Love them. And yes, some people are easier to love than others. And so if we understand anything about the Word of God, it even tells us that we should love our enemies. What good is it that you only love people that are easy to love? But it's something major when you can love those that are not that easy. And sometimes people that hurt us, we view them as our enemy. And so I pray that this teaching has been a blessing to you all. I pray that it is the beginning of many people realizing that, hey, I do have this issue, and I need to get help, and I need to deal with it. I need to get healed, because if you don't, it will continue to spew over in so many different areas of your life, and you will continue to just to destroy good relationships because you haven't gotten healed. Get healed from your hurt. The church is not a perfect place. It is not filled with perfect people, and unrealistic expectations of people will disappoint you. And so, we thank those that have taken the opportunity to tune in. I know that this was a long teaching. Pray that it has blessed you. You want to know more about our ministry, please go to the website, www.mbttministries.com. in this house right now, we're getting ready to give financially our tithes and offering. But those of you all that are tuning in, you may have been blessed. You may have tuned in. You may want to sow a seed. You have the ability to do that through our website. So again, go to www.mbttministries.com. There's a link that says sow a seed. Also, you can find out our address. Come and worship with us because somebody found us on Facebook and they're here today. And we say thank you, Jesus. So if you get good enough to you and you decide I want to physically come, we welcome you. Amen. Be blessed. Enjoy the rest of your day. All right, y'all. It's time to give it to the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. I thank you all for your patience on today.